Good evening. Welcome to a conversation with Tina Guyani Collective Webinar. We have John and myself, Lale, from Calgary Public Library. We are the hosts for tonight's event. I would like to do some housekeeping before we start. This event is a Zoom webinar and we are scheduled from 7 to 8 p.m. You can ask your questions through chat. The Zoom controls are at the bottom of the screen. If you click on chat icon, you will have chat window on the right-hand side. Please use this window to ask your questions. I would like to acknowledge that we live on the ancestral and traditional Indigenous territories of the Blackfoot Confederacy, Siksika-Sitabi, the Siksika, Bigani, Guyana, and the people of the Treaty 7 region in southern Alberta, which includes Sutina, Iyaha Nakoda, nations of Chiniki, Bearspa, and Morley. The city of Calgary, Mohkinsis, is also home to Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3. Please welcome our panelist, Tina Guyani, Deer Road, Sutina are a two-person artist collective comprised of Glenna Cardinal and Seth Cardinal Dodging Horse. This mother and son duo are the 2020 Indigenous Artists in Residence. During their residency, they researched the ongoing history of Calgary pressuring the Sutina Nation to sell land. This research resulted in the artists creating new audio and visual works titled For 210 Chaguzagha-tsi, Weaselhead Road. This new work connects their family to these histories and the current construction of the Southwest Calgary Ring Road. And we have Mark Asberg, the CEO of Calgary Public Library. Welcome, Mark.
Great. Thank you, Lale. Thanks for getting us off started in the right way with that land acknowledgement in particular, because one of the things that we're speaking about tonight is the histories of this land and the histories that precede us and our responsibilities as we move forward together. Mm-hmm. I'm really delighted to be here with Glenna Cardinal and Seth Cardinal Dodging Horse, two really creative and incredibly generous and thought-provoking artists that I've had the privilege to get to know a little bit over the past year and a half. So welcome, welcome Glenna and Seth. I thought we would start this evening because your exhibit is actually present in Central Library as we speak, and there may be people who haven't had a chance to see it yet. If you were here a little bit earlier, you might have seen the slide that had a picture of the exhibit, but I thought we'd start with just if you could talk a little bit about the exhibit that's in Central Library right now and the kind of experience that people can expect with that.
Sure. Hello, everyone. Do you want to go or I'll start?
You start.
Okay. So while we were at the library, I think we were there for like a month and then the pandemic started. And then what my mom had been working on while we were there was, I was kind of looking at old maps and like whatever books I could find at the library that talked about Sutina history as well as Calgary's history and going back to like the 1800s. And while we were there, my mom started making some chairs and she made a bench and then you also made a shawl.
Yeah, a shawl as well.
And they're all kind of like construction themed and with like the ugly and beautiful like neon green and orange.
They're reflective, yeah.
And then, so then the pandemic happened and then for like, I don't know, several months, feels like a decade, but for like several months, it kind of felt like we didn't really know if, you know, we'd get a chance to have an exhibit, like what the scope of the pandemic would be and everything. But then, we ended up being able to install our show and everything kind of came together. We had like different things planned originally and then everything like fell together in a really nice way where, you know, we got an opportunity. And once we figured out the space that we'd have in the library and the main floor, and once we saw that we had the floor there, we were like, okay, well, we don't want to hang anything on the walls, and we don't want to, we kind of thought about maybe projecting things. And then I have like so many old TVs in my house that I've been like using for art that I like, I think I have like 5 or 6, and they take up a lot of space, but we decided to end up using the TV. And then, yeah.
Yeah, good thing we got to put everything together, because I started wrapping the legs with the alkyde. So the legs on the bench and some parts of the chairs, that's alkyde. And it was really, I don't know where it would have went. Everything would have been all wrapped if we didn't have to bring it to the show, you know, to share with everyone.
Right.
But it's community engagement and just kind of highlighting some of our feelings and thoughts and the work and that.
Great. Yeah. So, and it's really remarkable if people who are listening right now, if they have an opportunity to go, it was really remarkable the sort of experience of seeing that exhibit right in that space. And for instance, the beautiful chairs that you've created, and on those beautiful chairs is that sort of that green construction tape at the same time. And so the juxtaposition of those things has a real impact, and as well as the technology in that space surrounded by the construction ribbon and all of that. So. Can you tell us a little bit more, because this is part of your residency overall here at the library. So can you tell us a little bit more about, the inspiration for your overall project and why you chose this particular topic for your project?
Sure. Kind of going back, our original proposal, in a lot of ways, it ended up being very similar to what we originally proposed, but kind of like our backstory is kind of the reasons why we make the work that we do and the art that we make is because in 2014, we were displaced for the Southwest Calgary Ring Road. And so it kind of took us quite a few years of like making our own art, and also just like my family's very creative. My mom like makes regalia for like pow dancing for like me and my sibling and our relatives. And so we kind of ended up, we spent a lot of time talking about our experiences with being displaced, and it was really nice because, you know, we experienced the same thing and kind of like that same trauma. So we were able to talk with one another, and it was really nice because it was like, you know, someone who had the exact same experience. And so then we ended up collaborating, and then we got a call, or someone sent us that the library had a call for the Indigenous Artists in Residence. And then we ended up sitting together and talking, and you're like, what's something that we could do together and that we could make and that we could do at the library? And so what we were originally gonna do was, while we're at the library, we're gonna sit and visit with everyone. And then all the folks that would come and visit us in the studio at the library, we wanted to record their stories and see if they had any memories of either like the southwest part of the city or the reserve, and see if they could recall any memories before the construction or even during the construction. What we wanted to do is make an audiobook. And then we had a few people come and visit us, and then the pandemic started, and then we were like, you know, it's harder to be able to share stories with people like face to face, and that was something that was kind of important. So we ended up putting that idea on hold, and then we decided like, well, how can we share a story about our family and experiences, and how can we do this now? You know, we definitely had to shift it and make it accommodate the pandemic, and around our current installation, so we have it like taped off with these giant pylons. And originally what we wanted people to be able to sit on the chairs or to enter that kind of space. And then we thought it would be actually kind of interesting because the pandemic is a thing now. So we thought it'd be kind of interesting if we kind of taped and restricted the area. So then people were kind of, you know, forced to be on the outside and kind of have to like look in this different way. And we didn't, for this installation, we didn't really overthink too much of anything. Everything kind of, I think when we work together, everything kind of comes together in a nice way. And kind of how we shoot our first ideas is we like kind of tell each other what we're thinking, or like kind of show each other what we're making. And I think because this is my mom and I'm her son, we're able to be very harsh sometimes, or we're just like, yeah, that isn't cool. Or
is it like harsh isn't the word I would use?
Yeah, I don't know if it's like super harsh, but like sometimes we're kind of like get grumpy and we're like,
no, we move things. We set it out and we move it throughout the room. Like when we put it, and I have to book meetings with Seth now. So Seth is very busy with his own work and stuff. So I have to book meetings, and I'm like, so we finally got a meeting together just before we were going to install, and Seth had other footage that he was going to put in there. So we ended up having this new footage, you know, and then we saw the importance of everything just came together.
Right. Yeah. And the footage you're speaking of, the footage that's on the television there, is from the opening ceremony for the new highway from, I can't remember how many weeks ago that was, but when you actually spoke and got a fair bit of response from the community around that as well. So, yeah, so I was actually going to ask you guys about what it's like working as a mother and son duo, but you've already answered my question. Anyways, go ahead, Seth, you were about to say something. Sorry. Yeah.
Yeah. Originally the footage we wanted to... Yeah. On the television was everything I shoot is with a VHS camera, because I love the way it looks, and it makes everything kind of look nostalgic. And so originally what I wanted to do is I wanted to shoot a kind of infomercial about the ring road, and I was gonna kind of like pretend to be a reporter on the field. And so as we were gonna film on different construction sites on Sutina, and like the place where we used to live, where the road is, and it was gonna be a lot more kind of like satirical and have like a bit more of like dark humor. And so we're gonna shoot that and everything. And then I think it was October 1st, the ring road opened, and I ended up going to it and giving this whole speech. And that was all very last minute and unexpected. But when we went to it, the people that I came with, I went with a few people, and I got one of them to videotape it with a VHS camera. And they started filming, they like filmed everyone's speech and kind of the whole event. And so everything they kind of filmed is very different from like the news, because the news and the reporters that were there just turned the cameras on at like certain points. And so they have a lot more that take, the camera that's on the TV in our installation has a lot more before and after. And we decided to use that footage because it just, the speech that I gave and my mom's words, at the speech that I gave, my mom wrote this, this letter, and then I read that, and that letter that my mom wrote ended up summing up kind of everything that I wanted to get across in that video for our installation. Mm-hmm. And then it just like ended up working perfectly. And then we installed it, and yeah, it's kind of like one of those like very like off the cuff, like last minute things that like, you know, I was like, wow, this is much better. And I feel like in a lot of ways, like closer to like the heart of the things that we're trying to tell.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So how would you say the work of the residency, and you know, this pretty organic process that you're describing about, you know, how you got to this point, that that's affected you and your family and maybe even your community? Do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, the work in the residency was interesting, right? It was like being in the community in a different way. And we were really in the heart of Calgary, and it was really, I love that building, but yeah, so it was really interesting. It's sometimes you had people come in and they visited you, and then sometimes you had people just peek in, and sometimes you had short conversations and long conversations, and it was always something different all the time, which was really, really the neat part of it.
Yeah.
I really appreciated having that space. Yeah. I think you guys owe me another month and a half in that room.
It is a really beautiful space up there. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, sure. And so related to your, like the experience that you had in the residency and clearly how this is a very personal project for you, can you talk a little bit about, you know, in a broader sense, that relationship between art and healing, and if art has helped you heal, or if that's a fair question?
Yeah, I think for myself, at the time that we were moving for the Ring Road in 2014, that was like my first week of university, and I went to AU Arts, and so it was like very, originally all the art that I was making before was kind of like focused more on like nostalgia connected to like memories of being a kid and things towards that. And then I started to make work about the experience of moving and everything. And it was something where, you know, talking about moving and all of that and like leaving that history, like our family's history behind, and having all that, I just remember like not being able to communicate or talk about that with friends. So it'd be like, I'd be hanging out with friends, or my bands would be playing music and stuff. And it'd be like something where, you know, my friend would be like, oh, like, what'd you do this weekend, Seth? And that weekend I would have been like at our home, packing up all of our belongings and everything, and like having this intense experience. And then it's kind of like the thing where like, I didn't know how to talk about that and express it. So to my friends, I'd just be like, oh, I didn't do much. So it was like something kind of like that, where for like, when it came to like personal relationships, I had a hard time talking about it. And then as I started making art throughout the years, I found that I was able to communicate different ideas or different feelings. And I started focusing, a lot of my art started focusing on specific memories. So I'd be like, you know, I remember having like really great birthday parties in that house. So maybe I'll do an art performance where I give people like, throw people like my whole class a birthday party stuff, and kind of like give them instructions. And then I found over time it became kind of easier. So then when I was in my classrooms and stuff, I'd be able to like show my art and then also talk about, you know, where all of my thoughts and ideas were coming from. And just being able to talk to people in that way was really nice, and it made it much easier. That was kind of my experience.
Yeah.
I think a lot of like with my work, it's a lot of hands-on material, and having that, feeling that material and knowing that material.
Because you use blankets, right?
Yeah, I use a lot of the blankets, the Pendleton blankets, but I also, and I appreciate like the work with the elk, and I really love doing a lot of the stitching and a lot of the chairs that I've done, and the work are hands-on with even sewing the chairs by hand and that part of it, and using the sinew and really being tactile with my materials, kind of, yeah.
I remember you mentioned to me that, because a lot of the work that you've done recently is like chairs and benches and even made a table. And I remember something that you told me was that you like realized that you were kind of recreating like the home that we lived in and like all these home spaces.
Yeah, I didn't realize like I was in my mind making home beautiful again and using these beautiful material like the Pendleton blanket, which is like really a ceremonial blanket. Some people use it for gifting, you know, giving this wondrous expensive gift of the blanket, but I found that people put them in their closet and save them. So then I started getting this notion that we should have them out and use them, and they're so beautiful that we can use them in everyday items and within our homes. So yeah, it started out with me being very precise and cutting a blanket and making using it to recreate a chair, and then very precisely putting the pattern on and making a shawl to go with it. And then using every piece of the material very carefully to now where I look at, and you look at my work, I don't make them all that precise and all the patterns, you know, it's okay for them not to be fully there. And I like it that way, you know, having to look at it. And it's very important in my mental wellness, the work I do, because it seems repetitive, but it gives me a time to think. Like even with stitching the rawhide or stitching the blanket, I have those times and to think really about what I'm doing and how beautiful this is, and knowing that someone will look at my work too as well and enjoy it.
Right. Yeah. Thanks, Glenna. So I love hearing about the process. It's not just about the product, but that process is so important. And if people are interested, some of these spaces aren't open right now, but some of Glenna's really beautiful work is also in the Indigenous Languages Resource Center on the fourth floor of the library, and also in the Elders Guidance Circle, in particular, a very, I don't know what the word is, it's just an astounding table that Glenna has created in that space. And if we have time later, we can talk a bit more about that. I want to turn it over to some questions in the chat, but first I just want to ask you to make sure we have an opportunity to talk about you and your collaboration, but also individually, you know, what you're doing now and what the future looks like.
Cool. Yeah. We have a show planned that will be up in January, is it?
Oh, yeah. January in Articule in Montreal.
Oh, great.
Yeah, so we will have that opening near the end of January to the end of February. So it'll be there for a month. We've been working with different ways of getting that show. You know, we have like people with certain COVID restrictions and that. So it's really making us think out of the box and figure out how we're going to do that. We're still moving forward too as well with in the fall of 2021 with Stride Gallery in Calgary. So we'll have an exhibition in Calgary as well.
That's great. Awesome.
So Seth has more a lot of work that he currently has out traveling in Canada for the next 2 years.
Yeah.
You have a piece that's going around.
Yeah, I'm pretty busy. Busy. I know right now in Calgary, I made a sculpture for Contemporary Calgary has a Yoko Ono show going on right now. And I made a sculpture that talks about the Glenmore Reservoir. My cat's coming.
Yeah, thank you.
The Glenmore Reservoir is another portion of land that used to be a part of the Tsutina Reservation. Mm-hmm. So that land was sold in the 1930s, and so that's where like Calgary's drinking water comes from. And so I made this like, I didn't make, I reused this
water bottle.
It's like a giant water bottle, and it's actually one that my family uses to drink. Me and my grandpa used to drink because can't drink the tap water at our home. And so for that piece, I used that. And on the inside, I don't know, if it's kind of hard to see at certain times of the day, but on the inside I painted, it says, you drink Tsutina land. And then in the description, it kind of talks about the history of that. So I have been doing a lot of research on like Tsutina, like reservation lands, and how over time it's like shrunk because of like all these colonial reasons and farmers wanting land and the city of Calgary wanting land. So looking at maps is another thing that I've also been started to do and want to do a bit more of. So
Yoko Ono is part of his sculpture.
So. Oh yeah, yeah.
So you collaborated with Yoko Ono too.
Yeah, we collaborated in some sense.
Yeah. Awesome, great. Thank you so much, still coming. I'm gonna turn it over to John for a second to see if there's any questions in the chat that that people would like to ask.
There. Hey, John. So we just have a couple so far here. The first one from Jerry is asking if you could walk us through your installation at the library. For those who haven't been able to visit yet.
Sure. So basically the way we have it set up is, so when you go on the library doors, there's this kind of huge atrium, and then there's this long concrete floor. And then within the space of that atrium, we have installed these giant pylons, and I think they're like 4 feet, I think they're about 4 feet tall, but we kind of have them set up like a perimeter. So it goes in a kind of a rectangle. And then we have it taped off with this orange, is it gaffer's tape? Green gaffer's tape. And then we have within that perimeter, we have two chairs that my mom painted and she reupholstered. And those are the ones that she made at the library. And then there's a bench. And the two chairs are kind of facing away from each other. And in the middle of them, I have this kid's play rug that's like, looks like the city. And it's like those ones where you
drive cars on them.
Yeah, I used to have one as a kid that you drive like your Hot Wheels cars on. And so I have that in the middle. And then placed on top of that mat is a white hat, and it's a white cowboy hat. And that's a sign of hospitality in Calgary. I think it started with one of the mayors in the 1940s, but it's whenever like celebrities, who was it? Was it Prince Harry?
Prince William.
Prince William. So when Prince William came to the Calgary Stampede, they gave him this white hat. And so when different celebrities and kind of well-known people come to Calgary, it's kind of like a ceremony in a way to give the white hat to someone. So I have a lot of friends that aren't from Alberta that like will make fun of the white hat, and they'll be like, what's up with that white cowboy hat and everything. So it's kind of like this funny thing that I think it's funny, but I have it set up on this play mat, and the mat looks like a city, but it has some roads that are under construction on the mat. So I thought it looked like the Southwest Calgary Ring Road in a way. And then in front of that, we have a small CRT TV. So it's just like an old TV with a VHS player. And then on that TV, we have looped footage from the speech that I gave at the opening of the Ring Road. And at the opening of the Ring Road, I wasn't on the itinerary to give a speech that day. I just showed up and happened to give a speech in front of the cameras that were broadcasting live that day, and it kind of I thought I was just talking to the people on the road that day, but it kind of ended up getting shown and shared across the world, which was really nice and unexpected. And just across from that TV, my mom made a bench.
The TV's on a shawl.
Oh yeah.
So a shawl that I hand finished with the fringe. And then I agreed to let Seth put his TV on it.
Oh yeah, the shawl's on the floor. And originally when we were like playing around with installing it, my mom was like, so where does the shawl go? What are we gonna do with it? And it's like, I think we should put it on the floor. And so,
but that was really hard. So anyways,
we put it on the floor.
So yeah, so the bench, the bench is hand stitched with the elk parfletch, like the elk skin, the rawhide. And then that was hand stitched, kind of my way of protecting it. And then I don't know if you saw in the back, I have Star Wars.
Oh yeah, she you reupholstered the back, right?
Yeah.
And the fabric that's on the back has baby Yoda the child from The Mandalorian, and then like it's a repeat pattern, and then beside the child it says, "This is my good side." And so I remember you put that on, and that was pretty funny because I wasn't expecting that.
So I also, hand stitched the cushions and and put on the construction tape.
Yeah. I would really encourage everyone who has an opportunity to come and visit, because it is a very captivating display. And tying some of what you spoke about there ties into another question from one of the participants. Do you feel that there's more eyes on you and more attention to the cause, especially with the video and the opening ceremony, which I saw that and it was very powerful as well. So like how does it feel to have more attention on there? If there is any, do you think?
How do you feel?
Scared. I feel that it's pretty cool. I don't know. Seth's had videos that had a lot to do with the Ring Road in the plus 15. You know, like years ago. So he's done, you know, even in the other memorial library too. So he's done a lot of work with the videos and that. So it's pretty, it's interesting. I think people didn't realize that we already had the connection with the library, and we had that planned already for that installation. So we knew something was going in there, just the footage changed. How do you feel?
It was pretty unexpected to get the, because after I gave that speech, I started getting like hundreds of messages on all of my social media online. And after I gave that speech, I was like burnt out and dead. I was like, I'm gonna go home and like lay on the couch and play video games or something. And then, so I kind of tuned out for a couple hours, and then I remember checking my phone and seeing that I was like receiving hundreds of messages, and pretty much all of them were all really nice and supportive. And all of the work that we've been making and that I've been making in my own art, I've been saying like a lot of the same things that I said in that speech that day, and the things that my mom wrote. And so, I've had times where I've done art or I've done things and I felt like no one was really paying attention. And then sometimes people would pay attention, and then sometimes people, I think for people like Tsutina people, some other Tsutina people, it's kind of hard to look at things that kind of address community issues. And there's like a big issue where it comes to kind of, you know, like if there's something going on that's bothering people, sometimes it's kind of easier to just ignore it and keep on just to walk by. And so when I gave that speech and kind of saw how people that like that video went online, and there's like a version of the video that got like a few million views. And so is pretty intense to kind of look and then see that, you know, so many people were seeing and were listening and that were like connected with the message in that speech that I gave, and sort of like the actions that I did that day. Like I ended up cutting my hair, and that wasn't planned. I think the funniest thing was there's also been like a bit of negative feedback, but I ignore all of that. I don't pay too much attention to it. And being First Nations, it's kind of something where it's like when you go online, you're like, oh no, I know I'm gonna get hurt today if I read the comments. So I don't look at the comments or anything, but I just remember one of my friends told me that a comment that they saw was like talking about our installation at the library, and it was like, they planned that speech at the Ring Road to promote their show at the library, which I thought was funny because like we installed the show after the speech and everything, and we're like, we had this like planned since like March and everything. And so yeah, I think it was really nice that that I did get a lot of messages from other First Nations people that had similar experiences, which was also like pretty intense for me to hear and everything, but it was really nice to know that other people also felt heard and seen. And so I think overall there's been a lot more good than bad, and it's something that we're gonna continue to talk about and to share. And I think it's good that, I think it instigated a lot of conversations between people that normally would look away from those things or those issues. And so I think it's good that people feel the need to have these conversations now. And I think that's a nice thing that has come out from it.
Awesome. And definitely a conversation in engagement starter for sure. And very, yeah. Thank you. Some other questions here. We've touched on this a little bit earlier, but with the process of grief and the journey through there, one of the participants is wondering if you have any advice, I suppose, for how to work through.
Yeah. I think if it's like for working through grief, and I think going to counseling. So it was like, because sort of as I started to open up more in my own art, I also started going to counseling as well. And it was really nice to be able to talk to someone and feel heard. And so I think, because I wasn't talking to other people as well at the time, you know, kept a lot bottled in. So being able to talk about it more, and then the art that I made was talking about those things. Originally it was kind of more vague, and then I felt like it got more direct and was able to communicate things more directly, and kind of pay attention to how I was communicating those things. And so like definitely making art, like I think about what would happen, you know, sometimes I've thought about like, where would I be if I wasn't going to school at the same time and I didn't have that opportunity to be able to explore my own feelings and make art about my feelings and stuff. So it's, I think, you know, being able to share things with others has really helped, and being able to share things with my family and my mom. And yeah, how's it been for you?
So we're talking about which again?
sort of, I guess, the journey of and advice for the road, like the long, sorry, bad choice of words there, but the journey through processing different, like, difficult emotions and specifically, I guess, grief.
Yeah, I think it's, so at the time I finished my degree in social work at the UFC, and I just so happened to be taking a class in grief and loss. So I was handed a book. I passed the class, but it didn't really help me. It's taken like 6 years now. So it's 6 years of counseling, continued counseling, and having to deal with PTSD, and to realize that it's a unique journey, having to explain to someone your grief with land and loss and home and your connection to the land and grief. All that is what I learned about myself, and you can't find that in a book. Yeah. And just continue to find that person that will help you. You know, it's okay if you don't, things don't work out with one person, you're gonna keep looking and you'll find that person to help you.
Thank you for answering such a difficult question and sharing on there. Another question from the chat here is, changing course a little bit here, who are some of your artistic influences for both of you?
Well, no, I was just thinking back, a lot of what I learned from Seth is what he's like, Mom, I have to show you this artist, and a lot of times that's where I got my my art education, and he showed me Carl Beam. And Carl Beam is an Indigenous artist. And once I saw Carl Beam's work, it was just like I could relate to it. And it was really neat seeing it. And then I had the opportunity, to see it in a gallery in Ontario in real life. And I was like, wow, it just blew me away. So Carl Beam was really important to me.
I like Carl Beam too. A lot of the art that he made kind of subverts what people expect Indigenous folks to make and the art that they make. And sometimes he plays into kind of like stereotypes and flips them on their head and with different things. Some artists, I was super into Yoko Ono. I still am. That was a big one for me. Because growing up, I was a huge Beatles fan, and I never got all the hate that they had for Yoko, because Yoko's cooler than all of them. And yeah, I think music, before I really got into art music, I'm a musician as well, and I was really into, like, especially records and like the album art, and kind of like the listening experience of holding a record and then you listen to music and you kind of are transported. And, you know, because sound is invisible, and being able for myself to kind of pay attention to like kind of how music is very like multi-dimensional. And so I was like super into like punk music, and then I got into experimental music when I was a teenager. And then learning about different sound artists. And I think like a big thing for me now is seeing like the art that my friends make and other artists, like my friend Suzanne Kite. She is an amazing artist who's Indigenous, and she does a lot of really cool things with like technology, and I think like pretty much a lot of my friends influence me now because I see a lot of the things they make and I get like really excited and I'm like, ooh, like I want to make something cool now. And yeah, I'm pretty bad at like name dropping artists. I like go blank. I'm like, but yeah.
And just circling back to Yoko here, what was that experience like collaborating on the project at or the exhibition at Contemporary Calgary?
It was very mysterious, and I thought it was a joke at first because I got an email that was just like, "You're invited to collaborate on a sculpture with Yoko," and then. I read the email and I was like, oh, that's pretty funny. This is the first type of chain mail that I've got that's like this. And then I read it and then responded and then it was legit. And it was pretty interesting. I think I'd be down to do more collaborating with Yoko and be cool to do it face to face. And
yeah, not in a pandemic.
Yeah, I think. Yeah, collaborating on art over computers isn't as cool as being able to hang out with someone in a room. But yeah, it is a fun experience.
Awesome. And for both of you here, what do you have planned for the future upcoming artistic endeavors that citizens of Calgary and beyond can look forward to? And will it be focused on the challenges that fellow Sutina and neighbors face?
I think for the art that we make, it kind of focuses more just on our own experiences and kind of communicating kind of within our little bubble. And some of those things we communicate kind of touch on other issues that affect other people around us, but we're always pretty careful to make sure that we're just like coming from our own experiences and everything. And yeah, I think we're going to continue to make stuff around it for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, that's about it. You said enough.
I think one of our dream projects, if anyone wants to help us, is we really want to do billboards along the ring road. So that's like something that I've been like putting out there that I want to do, and I'm like waiting for someone to be like, let's do it tomorrow. Yeah, I think doing more public art would be awesome. With my friend Feng Ling, we're collaborating on a utility box that'll be just across from the Center Street Bridge. And for my side of the utility boxes, I have images of the Tsutina Chief Bullhead, who signed Treaty 7, standing next to his wife. And on the other side, I have like Gutsiste, that's how you say like the elbow or the elbow river, or kind of like Calgary in Tsutina. And I have that there. And I was gonna have a blurb about the past system because my Tsutina ancestors all lived and camped along the elbow river there and the Bow River. And it was interesting that they used to camp there and then they were forced out of there. And then Calgary sprung up there. And then once they were put on the reserve, they needed a pass to get permission to leave the reserve to go to shops in Calgary. And so the piece that I'm kind of working on for my side is kind of talking about like the history of living on that land and then also like needing permission to go and travel to it. And yeah, I think for both of us, I think public art, something around public art. And even though it's like not necessarily our job to educate people on all these issues and everything, I find for some things that it is kind of nice to be put in a position where I can comfortably educate others and where it doesn't feel like a task or I don't feel like I'm being tokenized and all those things.
I think the pandemic really changed the way like our next work and our next exhibitions are in actually been put back, and then now they're coming back to us. So they're kind of like, we had these planned and they should be on now, but because of pandemic, we've moved back, and we're just trying to play catch up with everything. And like, I'm continuing to make new pieces at home, and then they'll get out there.
Yeah, my mom's working on a beautiful blanket with pennies sewn on it, and yeah, it's an interesting scene because I'd like go over and visit her, and she'd be sitting on the couch watching TV, and be like, "Oh, what are you doing?" She's like, "I'm just sewing my pennies." She's like attaching these pennies and stuff, and so it's like, the work that my mom does is very different from my own, so it's kind of nice to see the things that she makes and then kind of like learn her own perspective on what she's doing. And then because I'm not that great at sewing yet, and I'd like to do more sewing and more tactile work with like fiber and all that, but a lot of the work that you do uses like different kind of like fiber and materials and blankets and things, and so I think you have a lot more patience than I do.
Yeah, I think when it comes all the way back around is when I first met Mark and we worked on the library cards. So that was very huge. And Seth helped me with the library cards as well. And that huge, with those photographs of my grandmothers and Seth's great grandmothers is connecting it, because they're the ones that lived on the ring road, and they're the ones that their land is gone now. So I was pretty fortunate that when we started, you know, advocating for the library cards and the photographs, that it's come full circle, that we have, you know, these images that hold a story, and this connection is part of, like you say, it's Calgary's story as well.
Yeah, so for people who don't know much about the library cards, it's you can get more information on our website, first of all, so calgarylibrary.ca/indigenous, and there's the story of the library cards are there. And Glenna very generously approached the library with this project, and I think it's a really beautiful project, and I was so honored to be a part of it. And there are now library cards with images, particularly of Indigenous women from Glenna's family, her ancestors who lived on that land. And you know, part of this is all about having representations of Indigenous people on library cards to reflect that inclusion in the space of the library. And it's just such a pretty powerful way to express that. And so we're really grateful for Glenna for bringing that project to us.
Yeah, very cool.
It's pretty cool. So, and there's still cards left. There was an initial print of about 10,000, and they were going really fast. But I'm told that there are still some cards left in locations. So it is limited edition. So if you would like one, it is available to anyone who would like one. All right, we are getting pretty close to the end of our time, I think. So I would just really like to thank Glenna and Seth for their time, for their art, for their creativity, for their community spirit, for their generosity of spirit, for all you do, and for this wonderful conversation, and for answering these questions about your art and your experience. It's been really wonderful, and I'm extremely grateful for this. So thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Yeah,
thank you for having us. Thanks to everyone who came and asked questions and stuff.
Great.
And I'm sorry if we haven't been able to get to all of your questions there, but I will be showing the last slide here. We'll have another viewing of the exhibit if you're not able to make it here. So if everything goes correctly, that'll show up here. And just again, thank you very much to all the participants for coming tonight and everyone's engagement on chats and joining us this evening. And if you're interested in any more programs from the library, we have lots of online ones. Please visit us at calgarylibrary.ca/programs.